You see what's coming down? The light of what? Light of the gospel, the light of his presence, the light from his glory. Individuals have different, you know, different versions of what they're seeing there as well. Let's move on in the memory verse. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. All right, so, you know, as a growing Christian, you know, one of the things when I was a lot younger, you know, you're growing up, you say to yourself, man, they say that when we get to heaven, we're going to praise God to, you know, for the ceaseless ages of eternity. And you say to myself, man, that doesn't sound too heavenly. I think I'll get, you know, tired of that after a while.
You know, that same thing came to me.
Oh, it came to you as well, huh?
Yeah, somebody said, I asked the person, and they said, you know what, why you say that? Because you're thinking of earthly.
Okay, yeah. Earthly things, right? And that's one of the reasons. The other thing is that I think that we all fail to do, and that is to meditate. You know, meditate. And I, you know, some of the psychologists say that one of the things that we lose the most as we get older is the ability to have an active imagination, so to speak. When I was young, I could go outside and play with the ants on the side of the house with my Legos for an hour, 2 hours. You know, you wouldn't catch me outside on the side of my house playing with my Legos. Imagining things and making up stories and playing for hours and hours. Because as you get older, your imagination tends to diminish, right? But as we get older, the imagination is actually replaced by something else that is extremely powerful. And that word is?
Reality.
Meditation. Huh? Meditation. All right? See, young people, your kids don't meditate. Older people meditate, right? And this is why when you read the Psalms of David, the reason why his praise seems to be never ending is because David knew that as an adult, I don't so much imagine as I meditate. So then David's sitting out there, he says, the heavens declare the glory of God. And the firmament showeth forth his handiwork. And he says, day after day, now all these different things. David is a shepherd sitting out in nature. And while he's sitting there in the middle of the night, Lord, your blessings are, you know, as numerous as the stars. Even when the Lord told Abraham about, he says, look up in the sky and try to count the stars. He says, your seed shall be more numerous than what you're seeing. Because once you start counting, you're going to lose place and you're going to have to start all over again. It's going to be that profound. Anybody know what I'm talking about? So what I'm saying to you is that as we go from week to week, we have to understand that if we don't meditate on these things, we're going to miss a whole lot of what God has planned for us. Anybody have any thoughts on that meditation? Because I have multiple examples of this, right? You want another example? Another example. Yeah, I like to go fishing. But what I pull out of the water and being on the water gives you a slight appreciation. When I started doing deep sea diving, scuba diving, right? When you get under the water, you get down 20, 30, 40, 50, 80 feet, you're going to see something totally different. Totally different. And it gives you a whole new appreciation for the ocean. In fact, they're still saying that probably 90% of the species on this planet have yet to be identified, and the majority of those are in the ocean, right? So, if we just looking at the ocean, if we just skim the surface, we're gonna find ourselves getting bored after a certain period of time. But once you get below the surface and you start meditating and really investigating exactly what it's all about, you're gonna get a fresh new perspective on things and things of life. And so what I'm telling you that to tell you this, when you start focusing on God, who he is, what he has done, what he is still doing, and when you take some time to do it, and when you go to heaven and you're living forever and ever and ever and ever, and you have a whole lot of time, you have a whole lot of God to consider. And our minds can't even grasp it now. This is why Paul says, I have not seen, neither ear heard, neither has it entered into your simplistic mind, the things of God. So when he said we're going to praise him for the ceaseless ages of eternity, we can't comprehend it in our temporal minds, in our finite reasoning. But when all of these things are opened up to us, and we see all the things that God is doing, then we're never going to stop. We're never going to stop praising him. All right, everyone follow what we're saying?
Okay.
Right? David, you read through some of the Psalms. God is so powerful. He's upholding the world. He's controlling all the breath. He's telling the ocean, you stop right here. Don't go any further. He's telling the springs to spring up. He's saying, well, you do this now so I can feed the sparrows. You do this now so I can feed the jackals. You do this now so I can feed the rabbits. You do this now so I can feed the plankton, which provide the so-and-so. And if God is orchestrating all of this, not by happenstance, not because of evolution, but because of his mighty power and the immenseness of his foresight and his design. And once you get down on those things, then you say to yourself, wow, right? And then you'll be in awe and you can praise him, all right? Anybody know them, you know? Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can see a lot, again, in the ocean. Now, I was reading in the paper this week, and I said, I like to keep my gospel real. Somebody received a pig kidney. Did anybody see that in the news? See, a lot of us, you know, we look at it, we scratch the surface. We say, oh, you know, that pig, that unclean animal, they train. But if you read the article, what you're going to see is just how advanced and how the words of is it Daniel 12, you know, knowledge shall increase, men run to and fro. That knowledge is going to be exponential. For all of us who are not following in the news, we're hitting the fourth industrial revolution is happening now in society with cryptocurrency or cryptography, blockchain, artificial intelligence, quantum computing, all hitting at the same time. This knowledge increase is not going to be linear. It's going to be exponential, which means it's going to go up like we're going to change from one day to the next. So when you read that article, it says that mankind has investigated the chromosomes and the genetics of the pig to the point where they can repress certain genes that would be expressed on the kidneys of the pig, that if you put it into a human's body, the body will reject it right away. But no, they programmed these pig cells, these pigs, you know, kidneys, so that those markers are no longer identified by the human. And now they can transplant this kidney from this pig into this human, and the human body will recognize it as its own. You follow what I'm saying? That's some serious science, man. That's some serious science. But instead of us being disgusted by the morality or the fact that it's a pig instead of a goat or a cow, what you should be in awe of is, wow, the mind of man is increasing exponentially. But when you look at the greatness of what man is doing, you should be saying just how great who is. Guess how great God is. Go ahead.
I know your point, you know, but, you know, you being a meta doctor, the DNA of
yes.
human beings,
mm-hmm.
I think like the 10th ring down, you have the double helix,
mm-hmm.
and each rung is ascribed a number, and I think it's a pattern. It's 10, and then it's 5353, something like that.
Yeah.
And what it is when you take that number and just and ascribe a Hebrew letter to it, it's Yud, Hey, Vav, Hey, which is the name of God. You've heard of that?
No, I haven't heard of that. But I would not be surprised. Because, you know, as Isaiah or Solomon says, it is the glory of God to hide a thing. It's a saying, or it's to man's glory to discover it. The Lord hides a thing. It's to God's glory for man to discover it. We're going to see a whole lot, but instead of magnifying ourselves, it should be magnifying who? Our Creator God, that He made us. And just think that we aren't even as smart as the antediluvian yet. Collectively, we may be approaching the intelligence of the antediluvian, but the antediluvian individually was smarter than we are even now. So it's our common language and et cetera, that allow us to come together and do great things and do great wickedness. But the antediluvian as an individual was probably more intelligent than we are. Brother Jeff, you had something you wanted to say?
Yes. The kidney.
Yes.
From a spiritual point of view, what the Bible have to say about that?
Well, I don't think the Bible needs to mention that at all. As far as being addressed, that's not my point. My point is knowledge is increasing. The ability for mankind to do great things, both positively and negatively, to unravel DNA, change genes, and put them back in, and the cells still be living, is a phenomenal feat. And it's the arrogance of man, actually, that brings about the judgment of God. The judgment of God. So we're living in some very trying times. You're going to see some explosive things happen in science over the next several years. I'm just warning you guys that it's going to make your head spin. It's going to make your head spin. But as we exalt man, make sure that we look behind or scratch below the surface and see just how awesome God is, how awesome God is, right? Let's move on from that. So we have to meditate more. Ellen White says we should meditate about the life of on the life of Christ for at least a good half hour to an hour every day. Because just reading about what He's doing is one thing. Meditating on what He's doing and what He has done, you know, for us is another. And it's going to change your perspective of who God is. It's going to deepen your desire to praise Him and to give Him the honor and the glory that is due His name, right? So that's what I'm saying, the worship never ends. Once you are exposed to just how multifaceted God is and all the hundreds of thousands of gazillion things that He has done, that's why the worship never ends, right? Looking here, lifting up our hands in the sanctuary, right? So, I was talking to my teachers this morning about First Chronicles chapter 9. The author, The End of Sundays, makes a point that's one of my favorite. Peter is saying that we are royal priesthood. Now, in First Chronicles chapter 9, the priesthood that were involved, or the priests that were part of the priesthood that were involved in the work of God, or in the temple, each subset or family of the Levites had a different task to perform within the sanctuary. Everyone aware of that? Some baked bread, some trimmed the candles and made candles, some made the apocryphal, made the incense that were burned, some cleaned up, some carried tents, some did a variety of things that were done. And so the analogy that I really want to pull out of it is that in those times, if those who were priests were actively involved in ministry, then now in 2024, and we are a royal priesthood, we should actively be involved in? All right, so this is, you know, one of my things as being elder in the church. If I were to stop any member on any given Sabbath or any given day and ask them, what is your role?
within the household of faith. Every member should be able to answer that question split second to say, what part am I playing in the body of Christ? And the reason why I'm saying this is that we're living in an age where people come to church to be entertained. Is that a fair statement? I'm not saying everybody, but the majority not just those who are not here for Sabbath school, but the majority of those that come in for a divine hour are coming here to be entertained. They want to worship, enjoy the entertainment of the worship experience, but if you're going to be part of the royal priesthood in 2024, you need to follow the old blueprint. Those who were actually part of the of this royal priesthood always had a ministry. You always had a ministry. And you always need to be working. And one of my mantras is in church is, you know, first of all, you don't have to possess every trait to be working. All the Lord is asking you to do is to use the one talent that he gave you, all right? So whether Sister So-and-so is more talented than you or you're more talented than her and she's more talented, that's irrelevant. God is saying that in 2024, as a member of this royal priesthood, there has to be a job somewhere within the household of God. You know, David says, I just want to be a doorman. I just want to be a doorman. He said, I wish I could just be one of the birds sitting up on the I just want to be here and be a part of it somehow. Right. So I'm just saying that because whenever we meet in business meeting or we have election of officers, we spend weeks and weeks begging people to take positions within the household of faith. Most would rather sit on the sidelines, watch, criticize, and be entertained. But when you're part of the body of Christ, in order to be living and breathing, every part of my body serves a function. You say, Maze, what's the purpose of your skin? I'll tell you. Hey, how's that big toe? It pushes off the majority of the force when I'm running. I need that big toe. You think the little one's that important? No, I'm not saying that at all. I stubbed that the other day on the side of a desk, and man, it sure was important because it sure hurt a lot, huh? And you can go all up and down the body. Everything has a function, and we're all part of the body of Christ. We're all part of this royal priesthood. We should all be individually, acutely aware of what role, what work, what ministry we are attached to, in regards to the body of Christ. Everyone follow what I'm saying, okay? Go ahead. Well, we motivate them. Well, we're motivating them now, even in Sabbath school.
I know. Right? For example, when I was growing up in Barbados, even the younger ones, I remember so vividly, after church, we had no choice but to go and pass tracts.
Yes.
We had to go and collect and gathering during the gathering season. We had to get every Sunday morning and go knock on the homes, whether people like it or not. We got cursed sometimes and whatnot.
Yeah.
But we were actively enrolled to go out and spray the word as it pertains to our faith.
Yes. Well, that's one way of doing it. You know, I even read, we read an author in the men's ministry a while ago that stated that as a church, we should be more intentional and systematic in how we indoctrinate our young people. So there are a couple of books available out there that do spiritual gifts inventory for young people. So usually I know in this church, when we talk about spiritual gifts inventory, we pass it around and most of the adults took them and filled them out, and you may like these areas and actually just ask you where you wanted to work. Anyone ever done that here in this church? All right? Spiritual gifts inventory. But this author was saying that we should start that even with our youth. Start identifying, you know what they would enjoy and installing our youth in these ministries and getting them started, and that would be the best way to start them in ministry and transition them from young adulthood and to being adult warriors and workers within God's church. And not just being, you know, a matter of happenstance, but being intentional and being systematic in how we bring them in to the concept of ministry. The other thing is you have a lot of individuals, you know, stating that, you know, I did this and so-and-so, you know, talked about me, or I did this and people just criticized me, or I did this and it was painful and I just can't be bothered anymore. I reminded everyone years ago, preached a sermon here about being a good soldier. And I made the point in that sermon that when we go to war as a nation, in several of our wars, the majority of the people killed on our side were killed by
friendly fire.
You guys know that? one of the hardest things to do when you're in the battlefield and everyone's in the bushes hiding and looking to ambush somebody is you walk up on your own crew, and you don't identify them as being them, and you end up killing your own people. And working within God's army, the same thing happens. Many times we're working with one another, and some of us are going to get hit by friendly fire. Right? It may be intentional, maybe accidental. If you want to say, I'm not saying that the analogy is 100%. I'm just saying that there will be some loss of footmen as we work one to another. But at the same time, understand that that is the nature of the of how we work in the work of the devil, and you got to keep pushing through it. Why? Because I'm in this army, not for the president of the United States. I'm not for this army, not for the president of Russia. I'm in this army because I'm part of God's army. So therefore, I'm willing to take the blows. I'm willing to persevere. I'm willing to keep on pushing, and moving on. Why? Because God is going to bless me. He's going to give me my reward in the end. So I'm fighting that good fight of faith, and I'm going to shield myself with the armament that He has given me, and I'm going to keep it moving to His name's honor and His glory. All right. I mentioned Russia just now. I was always going to, you know, keep things relevant for my class. You know, they had the shooting in the concert hall in Moscow yesterday. Everyone heard about it. And every time I see the news come up on my phone, because I have my alert set, the number increases. So I think it started at like 40. Now the number is past 150. So gunmen coming in, saying that they're ISIS-related. Several gunmen, and they shot up a whole lot of people, and now the death toll is already at 150. And it could happen anywhere. And you don't need a lot of gunmen. You know, we've had a rash of what we call, you know, mass shootings. You know, this country, we qualify a mass shooting. I think it's four deaths or more. If you don't believe me, go home and Google it tonight. Number of mass shootings in the United States. You're going to see that we're up the last couple of years dramatically. It's happening when individuals are going into public places. They're in their homes. They're on their jobs. And they're shooting people, so we are all at risk. And as we hear about happening in Russia, forget the fact that they're invading Ukraine, forget the fact that they just, you know, elected Putin all over again. People have been killed. Lives have been lost. Families are mourning, and therefore we should be sensitized to that, and we should be praying for those families in Russia. Praying for those individuals who perpetrate such acts and feel that they are just in doing so. And we'll come back around to that just in doing so in a couple of seconds, all right? So let's move on in the lesson. Sing to the Lord a new song. It's my favorite day of the week. Sing to the Lord a new song. Now, every week we're talking about history. Is that the goal of the lesson, to learn history? Is that the goal of the lesson? Or are we just, you know, are we Old Testament history scholars?
No.
Oh, what is the purpose of this day's lesson?
Praise.
Excuse me? A connection to God. Okay. singing praises. But hit the nail on the head, Boswell. What is the ultimate goal of this of Monday's lesson? Huh? Is that what it is?
Recognizing God's goodness in my life.
Okay. Huh? A fresh recognition? And when you have a fresh recognition, what do? Thank you. All right, so the purpose really of Monday's lesson is less about the history and more about your present spiritual experience.
Mm-hmm.
See, what the author is trying to get you to understand is the Lord is taking each and every one of us through something.
Oh, yes.
We agree?
Yes.
You've been through something in your life? And typically, when we go through something that's dramatic, and we know that there was no way in the world I could have made it if it weren't for
God himself,
the presence of the Lord in my life. And once you get through on the other side and you look back on where God has brought you and how he did it, Bible is saying that when you look back, you say, Lord, have mercy. And then all of a sudden you start what?
Praising God.
You start praising him. You start singing a new what? A new song, all right? And so you just can't keep it to yourself. So that's the history.
Mm-hmm.
So the question for us this morning is, you know, why aren't you and I singing this morning? Have we missed opportunities to sing in our own lives? Sister Robin. Mm-hmm.
Jesus has been with us at that moment, yes, in that time as we were going through it. So we get to that intimacy, you know, it's just something that you then want to remember, hold, yes, on to, embrace, because he's embracing us in, yes, that moment and had been and has been and will be.
Amen. All right. All right. So you can sing your own song. So there, like I tell people, you know, one day I'm going to be in church one day, and someone's going to sing my song, and Brother Mays is going to lose it, and you're going to think I lost my mind. See, the only reason you haven't seen it yet because they haven't sang my song. I won't tell you what my song is. Yeah. No, but everyone has a song.
Amen.
Right? And someone sings your song one day, you're going to sing it right. Man, it's just going to break you down. You're going to be like in your praise thing, and everyone's going to be wondering, what in the world is wrong with him? What's wrong with her? The thing is, we all have songs that are unique to us. And what I like looking at the chronology given in the lesson, looking back at Exodus 5, when Moses, you know, you got on the other side of that Red Sea, the beginning of the chapters, it says that Moses broke out in singing. And then at the end of the chapter, Miriam and the girl said, wait a minute. Y'all can't finish the song like that without me getting involved. And Miriam grabbed her tambourine. All the women got up, and they started with a whole new round of singing.
You can do it.
What I'm saying to you is that historically, when God has done great things, people break out in praise and worship, and usually ends up in a song, right? And so Moses started singing, and if you look at the verbiage in the Psalms and in Exodus, when they recognized just how awesome and powerful God was, they're like, wait a minute, the Red Sea, the sea was congealed like a wall. God's people walked over on dry land. And the thing that I feared the most that was hot on my tail, God delayed it, kept it from catching me. Huh? And then when I got to the other side, God is might let it down. And everything that I feared was killed that day in the ocean, never to be seen again. And so they were like, there's no way in the world anybody will ever believe this. And they put it into a song. Pharaoh's army drowned in the Red Sea, huh? And so it's something phenomenal. So they sing a song. Last week we said that when which king was that? Before they went to battle, the Lord told him, just go down by the brook and watch what I do. Israel won that battle against the people of the Ammonites and the Moabites and the king of Mount Seir. Won the battle. They never swung a sword. The Bible said the Lord took care of all of that army in one night. But if you look at what happened was they were singing on their way to the battlefield. Remember that last week? They were singing on the way to the battlefield. And so that can oft times be our greatest witness. See, if I tell you what God is going to do for me after he's already done it, most people are going to say, well, you know, that's probably just coincidence. You guys say there's God. All you Christians just crazy. Eh? But when you tell them before it happens, wow, and God comes through, and then wow, they're going to be like, wait a minute. Maybe this guy's hope is not as displaced or misplaced as I thought it was. Everyone see the difference?
Yeah.
And then many times, in spite of what you're going through, you have to continue to sing your song, because that witness, in spite of your current circumstances, is a great evangelistic moment for the heathen, right? So my hope should never be a shame. Everyone follow what I'm saying? In spite of what happens to me in the here and now, my hope is built on nothing less, right? So we all know. So what I'm saying, my present circumstance does not change my hope. Give you an example. When Israel was captured by the Assyrians, and they said, hey, sing us some of those songs of Zion. And the people sat there moping, how are we going to sing the songs of Zion in the strange land? They threw their harps up in the trees if you refused to play. But see, God put them there for a reason, and what their testimony should have been is, in spite of my present captivity, let me tell you, my hope is not diminished. So I can sing the songs of Zion in a foreign land. Why? Because I accept the fact that whatever God is doing for me right now, he's working it out for my good, and that the hope that I put my faith in is still intact in spite of what you see. So I can sing that song in a strange land. Everyone follow that? Now, again, the end game for this day's lesson was, you know, take some time. We spoke about this earlier in the lesson. We are older. There are no two-year-olds here. We're 50 and 40 and 30 years old. Your imagination is waning. You're going to have to meditate on your life to get to where you need to get to. Sometimes you got to sit down and say, wow, if it had not been for God's grace and mercy. Because, you know, you get a little older, you forget all the terrible things you've done and the fact that you're still alive and God has brought you through. But if you sit down for 5 or 10 minutes and then all of a sudden you start remembering all the things that you have done and the fact that you're still alive, that's when you get your praise on, you start singing a new song. So for me personally, I have a new appreciation for the word mercy. Mercy is God's undying commitment to his covenant with me. All right, so when I do ridiculous things, you say, Lord, have mercy. What are you saying? Lord, continue to maintain your covenant agreement with me. And when you get older and you start giving, you know, counting all the things that you have done, then you're going to say to yourself, man, I praise God. Why? Because his mercy endure forever. And he's been long-suffering, and he's been gracious beyond belief. Why? Because his mercy endureth forever. And then your song should continue to go on, and your praise should get, you know, should get deeper and sweeter and be continuous, because that's how worship never ends. Never ends. That's what we're talking about, right? Now, looking here, as we get here, who may abide in the tabernacle? How much time do we have? We got a couple minutes. Let's look at declare his glory amongst the nations. Let's look at that for a second, because we don't have time to finish everything. His glory among the nations. Now, we have a big problem in this country now with the judicial system. Everyone agree with that or disagree with that? Everyone is saying that people are going on trial, the government has an agenda, this one has an agenda, there's a deep state, there's this, there's political factions, there's special interest groups, there's a whole lot of things going on. Everybody seems to be disgruntled with justice and judgment. Hmm? David is saying, I will praise you, O God, for your righteous what? For your righteous judgments. For your righteous judgments. So when you're looking back, when we get to heaven, and we're going to see who got there, who didn't, and why God did X and why God did Z, one of the many reasons why our praise will never end is because as we investigate God's dealings with you and with me and with him and with her and with nations, we're going to keep saying, just and true are thy ways, O Lord, what? Most High. Worthy, worthy was the Lamb that was slain to receive honor, glory, dominion, and power. That's where all that comes from when we are focused on and meditating on the actions of God in regards to justice and judgment. Everyone follow what I'm saying? Because so it's going to be at a level of purity and righteousness that we have never experienced on this earth. The judge of all the earth, the righteous judge. So you know, so when Paul says, you know, I fought a good fight, I finished my course, I've kept the faith. He says, now I know that there's laid up for me, my crown, which Christ, the righteous judge, should give to me, and not to me only, but to all them that love his appearing. So Paul is saying, you know, I don't care about how you judge me. I know that I'm going to get my crown, and the person who's going to give it to me is going to judge me rightly. And this is why he asks us, you judge with righteous judgment. Don't judge one another, by the machinations of men. And then, you know, the books are going to be open, and we're going to see just how righteous God has been in dealing with each and every one of us. Any comments on that? Anybody have any comments on that? So I don't know. Anybody ever been to court and felt that you were wrong? They got it right. They thought they got it right and they got it wrong. You've been at work and things didn't work out for you and they got it wrong and you felt the injustice, or the police officer pulled you over, the IRS audited you, whatever the case may be, and you have a problem. The Bible's saying that you won't have that problem if and when you get to heaven, because you're going to look through the books, the Book of Remembrance and other books, and you're going to say, God, without a doubt, you have judged us with a righteous judgment. Looking at here went back to the wrong day. Let's close up some things here on Thursdays. Thursdays, many times, you know, we get caught up in minutia in worship, and that can destroy our experience. Everyone follow what I'm saying about minutia? Looking at John 20, Jesus got into a discussion with the, I believe it was the woman at the well initially. And she was deflecting, because deflecting when you're trying to have a conversation with someone and you're asking them questions and they're throwing out other things to keep you from driving your point home. All of a sudden, he's asking about her husband. He got no husband. She's all over the place. But then he says, I perceive that you are a prophet. You know, my friends say we should worship here, and others say we should worship over there. And then Jesus cuts her off and says, time out. The day is coming. Well, we will neither worship there or here. But the Lord is seeking those who are willing to worship him in spirit and in. And what does that mean? What does that mean? What does that mean? Doesn't matter where you are. What does it matter? What matters? All right. So you're praising him and you're worshiping him from the for the heart. So God is not confined to this building. If I were not in church today, if for whatever reason, I can worship God in my home. Why? I can worship God regardless of what kind of shoes I have on my feet and what I'm wearing or whether my eyeglasses are on or not or whether my hair is combed or not. It doesn't make a difference because God is searching for individuals that are worshiping him in spirit and in truth. And I'm reminded of the story of the two worshipers. You know, one comes in and says, you know, Lord, have mercy upon me, a sinner, smiting his breast. The other one comes in looking well-to-do and says, Lord, I'm so glad I'm not like other men. I haven't done this. I have my tithe in my pocket, and I'm going to return an honest tithe and pay a faithful offering. Thank you for blessing me. Amen. And Jesus asked the question, which one of those individuals left the household of God justified? And they say the latter. Why? Because his heart was in the right place. It was not, he had not shut him out by his own piety and his own pride and his own pomp. He recognized that he was in the presence of an almighty, all-knowing, all-powerful, just God. And it broke him down to the point where he could have the appropriate level of communion with him. And the Lord is letting us know that place and position, and clothing, those things are distant seconds. We really need to be focusing on loving God from the heart, not just following rules, not just sacrificing
Teachers,
a lot of animals.
You have 3 minutes.
Sacrificing a lot of animals in a mindless fashion, and this is a historical point. The size of the altar of sacrifice probably quadrupled from the first temple to the third temple. So what that shows you is not only had the nation grown, but the people have become obsessed with the act of sacrifice. So this is why when you read the book of Isaiah, he said the people have become desensitized to the sacrificial system. He says, you kill a lamb as if you were killing a dog. It means nothing to you. He says, I'm sick of your sacrifices. Who asked you to bring these things to me? So the Lord says, what is it that I really require? I want a contrite heart and a broken what? And a broken spirit. These things I would not despise. So as we look at worshiping, as far as worship never ends, make sure that what you're putting up to heaven is not something that is disapproved by God. What should never end is not that phony invitation. What should never end is that heartfelt presentation towards God for all of the mighty things that he has done. All right? Anybody have any questions or statements in regards to that? Yes. Oh, yes. Yes. So God in this temple, as you rightly said, I love this text as well. Wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, I am in the midst. And now with Zoom, you can Zoom me, and we can have worship because that's two or three on Zoom. And the Lord will be in the midst as well, right?
Just back to your point about serving, having ministry, being involved. The Levites, I was reading in Joshua 4, and their toes would touch the Jordan River, and then the flow of the river would stop coming downstream, and then the rest of it was going back down into the Dead Sea, and then again the Israelites were able to cross on dry land. So anyway, the point is that with the service comes the anointing. So the Levites, that was their position, that was their role. And they're used to that routine of and being obedient to what Joshua had told them, that the Lord had told him. And And when you are in the service, because, you know, Lord knows, we've all experienced it. I'm speaking from personal, too. Like, you take it the wrong way or you're offended. But really, maybe it's sometimes what God is trying to, like, refine in you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you get dissed by somebody or it makes you feel self-conscious about something that you did and second-guess yourself and everything. You know, it could be the Lord just trying to refine you in some way.
Okay. Right? All right. So I think a time is up for Sabbath school. But I hope you, you know, got a glimpse of the lesson. We should all be writing a new song based on our own life experiences and understand that our, in order for us to really comprehend and to praise God the way we need to, as adults, we need to meditate on His goodness. And to help us meditate, God has given us things, nature. Go up into the mountains, stand on one and look at the vastness of the world and experience your smallness in relation to what all God has made. And you see all of His majesty and His greatness. I was in Utah. I saw the mountains in Utah. I was in awe of the mountains of Utah. And when God descended on Sinai, the mountains were lifted up and on fire. And this is why Israel was so, you know, awesome and fearful of Him, because of His awesome might and His awesome power. We can have that experience if we spend more time with God in nature. May God bless you.
Thank you, teachers. Thank you, Asabi. Sister Desiree will now give us a summary of the lesson. Happy Sabbath, Church. Okay, I'm here to give like a few points on this week's lesson. It was an amazing lesson, right? All right. Worship that never ends. I mean, if we think about worship, worship has eternal attributes to it, because, you know, it's not only where we are now, but it's worship is going to be in heaven also, right? You know, when John talks about what he saw in terms of before the throne of God, the people were worshiping, saying, holy, 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 right? So worship is not only for earth, but it's going to be, it has eternal attributes to it. Sorry, let me just take this off. So this issue of lifting up your hands in the sanctuary, right? In the history of this, we know that the Levites were, when Moses came down from the mountain when the people were practicing idolatry, he said, who is on the Lord's side? And all the Levites decided to be on the Lord's side, right? So they were chosen for holy use, right? To be a royal priesthood unto God. So Peter writes that we are also a chosen nation, a royal priesthood, right? We were called from darkness into God's marvelous light. So we are to represent God's priesthood in even in 2024. So as we worship God today in what we do here in God's house, as well as who we come into contact with, it's very important that we represent God as His royal members of His royal priesthood. Worship, the worship of God also has blessings for us, right? Individually as well as collectively. So many people justify coming or not coming into God's house, but they're missing a blessing when they don't come together in terms of corporately worshiping God. One thing for Sunday is that my point is all hands on deck. So the Levites, when you read First Chronicles chapter 9, you're going to see that, you know, the Levites who I said all decided to be on God's side, right? And the thing is, every single one of them had a part to play in God's house. in terms of service, right? So we know even now the Bible says that God has equipped his church with everything in order for the edification of the body, right? So God gave you and you and you and you and me gifts. So why are we to use these gifts? We are to use these gifts for the glorification, for the building up of God's body. So if the question is today for you and I is, what am I doing with the gift that God has given me, right? If I'm doing nothing, work that out with God, because when he visits you, as he visits the men with the talents, he's going to hold you and I accountable for those very gifts that he has given us. So if you're inactive today, go to God, ask him, what will you have me do? You know, and just like the Levites, use those gifts in order to glorify God, to serve him, whether it's in here as well as outreach. Okay? A few more points. Oh, sing a new song. Sing a new song. So we all ought to have a song in terms of what God has done for each and every one of us, right? So when I reflect on Moses, when God took them through the Red Sea, they broke out in song, right? In worship to God for who he is and what he has done. And Moses purposed in his heart to say, the Lord will be his habitation. Go back and check that chapter. There's a lot in there. I can't decode now for the sake of time. But there was a new purpose in Moses' heart in terms of this new song. He said, the Lord is a man of war. How does he know the Lord is a man of war? Because of his experience that he has with God personally, as well as collectively with the body, the Israelites, right? So same thing for us today. God is a man of war. We know what he is. He has done to the enemy. He has conquered over the enemy. And he will do the... the experiences we have on day to day is to remember that we also have a new song about each experience, because in reflecting, it helps to strengthen our faith for the next situation, right? And on top of that, one more point about the new song is that it helps to strengthen others, right? David wrote Psalm 46, right? But in the battle of Jehoshaphat and the choir and, you know, the rest of the people of God broke out in Psalm 46 as their battle song, right? Moses wrote it, but they used it, right? So it helped to strengthen them in their experience, even though, David wrote Psalm 46, right? So your song is a testimony in and of itself to others, so they would see and hear what God has done for you and what he can do for them even in 2024. one more? Yes. Sorry. So that's a few the points for today, because we have only a short time. So let's live our lives worshiping God in spirit and in truth, not only in terms of outward or lip service, but God delights in us being a living sacrifice for him. It's not so much only about the lips. It's not about the lip service or the outward acts in isolation. Amen.
Thank you, Desiree. Today is a birthday Sabbath. So we'd like to ask all those who celebrate birthday in March to please stand. Birthday celebrants. Anyone that has a birthday in the month of March, last week, next week. Or Sister Burke.
Okay, we're going to sing happy birthday to Sister Burke. Stand up for your birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Sister Burke. Happy birthday to you. May the good Lord bless 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 you. Happy birthday to you.
Amen. Sister Burke. Now, Sister Ince would now bless her heart with the special music.
I know when she said Sister Ince, everybody's looking for Lika. Shh, don't say anything. I'm going to sing The Splendor of Heaven. Sorry. I'm only kidding. He left the splendor of heaven. I think because of the season, I just wanted to share the song. This is something I really like. But pray for me. He left the splendor of heaven, knowing his destiny. 'Twas the lonely Golgotha, there he laid down his life for me. If that isn't love, the ocean is dry, there's no stars in the sky, and the sparrow can fly. If that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this. If that isn't love, even in death he remembered the thief hanging by his side. He spoke with love and compassion, and he promised him paradise. If that isn't love, the ocean is dry, there's no stars in the sky, and the sparrow can fly. If that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this. If that isn't love, there's no feeling like this. If that isn't love.
Thank you, Sister Ince. If anyone did not receive a quarterly for the next quarter, you can see Sister Dean. I would like to thank all those who participated in Sabbath School this morning. Our closing thought, God is our creator, God is our sustainer, and God will be our judge. Our worship should be sincere and genuine, coming from a heart that desires to please God above all else. It is not about the music, the words, or the outward appearance, but it's about the condition of the heart. Let us worship God in spirit and in truth with all that we are, for he alone is worthy of all honor, glory, and praise. Let us purpose in our hearts to know God and to make him known. Amen. Sabbath School has ended. See you next week.
Mutis.
Good morning. Good morning, church.
Morning.
Happy Sabbath. It's good to see you. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today. Let us stand as we sing "Welcome into this place."
Unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation.
Amen.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the deep places of the earth.
Amen.
The strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his. And he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
Oh,
Sweet Holy Spirit, we invite your presence here today. Come into our worship, come into our hearts, come into our fellowship. May those of us who worship in this service, may those of you us who are visiting, may those of us who are watching online have a sense of your power. Father, we pray that our worship may ascend as a sweet savor and that it be acceptable to you, for we pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Our affirmation of faith is taken from John 3, verses 16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. The privilege is ours to welcome our visitors this morning. This is coming from the pastor desk, the first elder, and the deacon board, and the elder board. Will all our visiting friends please stand? Tell me where you're from and your name.
Name is Jaime. My wife, Vivian.
My name is Catherine.
Welcome.
My name is Berenice. I came from White Plains.
Amen.
Amen. Welcome you.
My name is John. I'm from Brazil.
Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
My name is Brian. I'm from the Bronx.
Amen.
This is my mother,
Amen.
Noris.
Amen.
Isaiah.
Amen.
Tadeo.
Amen.
Thank you.
Okay. Amen. We also welcome our regular members. Our church is more than just a place. It's a home for all, full of grace. With open doors and welcoming hearts, may you find a family that never departs. As we gather together in this place, or in this space, may you feel God's love and grace. For in this sanctuary, you will find a place of healing for heart and mind. Our home is where God's love is found, and in his presence, our hearts are bound. May you feel his love and our care, and know that you are always welcome here. Romans 15, verse 7 admonishes us to welcome each other. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you. I'm asking our members to welcome each other for the glory of God. So let's now take some time to greet each other.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
I will enter
his gates with thanksgiving in my heart.
I will enter his courts with praise.
say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
He has made me glad.
He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
This is the day.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Fernita. Today's story is called Let the Children Come. The memory verse is from Luke chapter 18, verse 16. It says, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Today's message is Children Like Me Are Welcome in God's Family. Can you remember a time when an important visitor came to your town? What did everyone do? Were there pictures in the newspaper? Did you stand and wave a flag? In our story today, someone very important has just come to town. It may have happened like this. Have you heard the news? Jesus.
Hello, church family. Hello. This song is called Holy Forever by C.C. Winans.
this prayer time, church. A time when we all can come together to intercede with God, to thank Him for all the blessings He has blessed us with in our lives. Amen. This week, today. And so if the Spirit moves you, I invite you to come draw a little closer as we approach the divine throne in prayer. From the north, we come from the south, we come from the east, and we come from the west, all gathered together under the shadow of the cross. We come, Lord, with different needs, we come with different fears, we come with different concerns. But we all seek thy grace. Father God, we want to acknowledge that we have not been the people that we ought to be. When we stop and we consider our lives over just over the past week, Lord, we start off by thinking we're going to do good. But we soon recognize that there is nothing good in us, that our nature is constantly towards doing otherwise. And so, Lord, as we gather here today, we just want to acknowledge that we are not worthy, but we're here anyways. Because of the cross. We're here because Jesus interceded on our behalf. And so we come boldly to thee, Lord, asking for your grace. Father, I'd like to lift up this prayer scroll this morning. Someone on this prayer scroll stopped to say thank you. They wanted to say thank you for your blessings. They want to say thank you because you gave them something that they prayed for. And so, Lord, all of us want to say thank you this morning. Because when we look on our lives, we recognize that you have been blessing us even when we don't deserve it. We make bad choices and still you bless us. So Father, we just want to acknowledge your grace and your love. But Father, on this prayer scroll are also prayers of tears, prayers of hope, prayers where we're simply petitioning the throne for grace. And so, Lord, on behalf of these prayers, we're here interceding on behalf of our brothers and our sisters. I don't know what those needs are. I don't know if someone here in this congregation this morning is in need of a job. I don't know if someone here in this congregation is in need of housing, is even in need of food. But, Lord, you know. And we pray, Lord, that even now you can give us hope. That if we trust you, that if we live according to your word, that you will in no wise turn your back on us. So, Father, it's on this promise here, Lord, that we're here today pleading on our behalf. Father, I'd like to lift up the speaker of the hour, Elder Mutis. Lord, I want to thank you for the word that you have given him today. We pray, Lord, that you may be with him, be with his family, be with everything that he does, be with his ministry. Father, we pray that you may put a hedge around him to keep him safe. So, Lord, even now I pray for that word that he has. I pray that you may bless it so that others who have come here today, Lord, that they will be blessed, that they will leave here, Lord, recognizing that your presence was here among us today. And so, Lord, as we raise up from our knees, we just want to thank you for all that you have done and all that you have promised. For we pray all of these prayers in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Chronicles chapter 18, verse 1 to 3. Now Jehoshaphat had riches and honor in abundance and joined affinity with Ahab. And after certain years, he went down to Ahab to Samaria. And Ahab killed sheep and oxen for him in abundance, and for the people that he had with him, and persuaded him to go up with him to Ramoth-Gilead. And Ahab, king of Israel, said unto Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, Wilt thou go with me to Ramoth Gilead? And he answered him, I am as thou art, and my people as thy people, and we will be with thee in the war. You may be seated.
This is a time where we started this week lesson about praising God. We sang, excited. Now is the part that we can praise God with giving. In Psalms 54, verse 6 said, I will sacrifice a free will offering to you, and I will praise your name. So the deacons will come now to pass the plate around, and I hope, as the Lord bless you, you will generously give to the Lord. And I pray that the Holy Spirit of the living God will move in this place, touch your people, to let them know that you're still on the throne and you're looking, in Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church. Oh, it's afternoon? Good afternoon. Oh, that's why you didn't respond. Good afternoon, church. Thank you for keeping me right. It's that time of the worship where we can lift our voices in songs of praise. Psalm 100, the first verse says, make a joyful noise. So whether you know the words or not, you're going to do what? Whether you can sing or not, you're going to do what? We're going to make a joyful noise. The first song we're going to do, making our joyful noise, is 426, I Shall See the King. Anybody looking forward to seeing the King? Oh, I like that. Me too.
I shall see the King where the angels sing. I shall see the King someday in a better land on the golden strand, and with Him shall ever stay. His glory. I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday. In the land of song, in the glory throng, where there never comes a night, with my Lord once slain, I shall ever reign in the glory and the light. In His glory I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday. I shall see the King, all my tributes bring, and shall look upon His face. Then my song shall be how He ransomed me and has kept me by His grace. In His glory I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday.
One more time.
In His glory I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. On a day like today, I think we're going to enjoy the next song we sing. It says, "Love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the very deeply stained within, sinking to rise. But the Master," praise God, "the Master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters He pulled me. Safe now am I."
Yes, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the Master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. He's the Master of the sea, billows His will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help. Love lifted me.
Oh, been a while since I've been up here. The church looks much bigger, actually, now. A little intimidating, but, you know, it's all to God's glory. Amen. Many of you know my story. But to those who are visiting, to those who are new, I was not part of the church for a long time. I veered off, and I did a lot of things, and for a long time, I was experiencing with certain addictions, alcohol, and did a lot of things that I regret, but the truth is that there is power in God. And one of the things that that was interesting is that I visited churches, and I will always get this call. They'll be like, get up, commit. And I'm like, no, I'm not ready yet. I'm not ready yet. And I kept prolonging it, because I thought maybe if I wait a little bit, I could get myself together and then I could come to God. But except that never happens. Continue to struggle. But the Bible says, come as you are, right? But you ain't gonna leave the same way. So I came to God and he was able to fix me and put me together. And I'm here alcohol free and just experiencing the joy and the greatness of God. I'd be remiss if I was to tell you that or introduce a special guest. My mother-in-law is here. Fonda, won't you get out, say hi? She is a wonderful woman. She has been a blessing in my life. She accepted me from day one as a son-in-law, even when I wasn't so good. But I appreciate her grace and her mercies, and I also want to thank Brian, who's here, part of our classes, Bible classes, Jimmy, and so many others. I really appreciate it. It's wonderful to have you all here. So when I was asked, I got a call from Dr. Mays, right? He's our first elder here, Jonathan Mays. And he tells me, Elvis, we need you to preach March 23rd. I said, all right, no problem. I'll be able to preach. You know, I rely on God. He gives me a message, and I'm always open, right, to hear what God wants me to do. But then after that, I get a call from Jackie, and she says, hey, Elvis, just a reminder that that March is relationship ministry, so we want to keep the theme kind of relationship. And I'm like, okay. But then Patrick Kay spoke to me a little later. He says, listen, it don't have to be the whole thing about relationship. We just want you to put a little snippet in it. Just point to it, so I appreciate the graces of Patrick. But it's still, if you don't know, I get really nervous when I wait before I preach. It's I get very nervous. So I start to say, oh man. And then one of the other things that I don't like to do, I don't like to speak or preach on something that I haven't experienced myself. I don't, or that I haven't kind of witnessed firsthand. So that kind of limit things. So I said, all right, well, what relationship dynamic could I possibly preach on? So I thought, well, maybe I preach on marriage. But I've been married 11 years. And while that may seem like some time in certain groups, here, like he's laughing at me already. That's not a very long time here. And the truth is that I just found out that Patrick and Jackie are going to be celebrating 37 years of marriage this July. Right? What am I going to tell him? Yes, Patrick and Jackie. How could I stand up here and tell him anything about marriage? And the truth is that while me and my wife's marriage is good now, today, I've witnessed how when trials and tribulations come, the union could be shaken to the core. I haven't passed through that. So I said, no, I'll pass on that. So I thought, well, maybe I could preach on fatherhood and, you know, raising kids. But my kids are only 7 and 11. I don't even know what the fruits of my labor are going to be, right? And the truth is that I've heard many testimonies from parents in this very church that says, man, you know, we reared the child and we gave them godly principles and morals, but they grew into adulthood and start living their lives, and they question whether this was the same person that grew up in their home. So I said, I can't preach on that, right? So I went back to God and I prayed. And he impressed me with the message that I'm gonna preach to you today. And to say, it's a simple message. I'm going to speak to you about friendships. See, these are the friendships that we spend years in developing. These are the friendships that go back sometimes 10, 20, 30 years that we have invested time and sometimes even money in. Those friendships that we have poured our emotions into, that we have gone to war with, that we have experienced joy, pain with, these relationships or connections that the Bible refers to as being closer than a brother. Those friendships that when we accept God, all of a sudden they become a stumbling block to our spiritual life. And I'm talking about the issue of peer and social pressure. It's simple. This refers to the influence of peers, families, and whatever social group that we have an emotional connection to. It can lead individuals to engage in behaviors that they might otherwise resist or choose not to do. We may think that's just impact kids, but the truth is that once you have a strong social, emotional, personal connection with someone or with a group of people, and happiness or benefits seem to be on the line, some have chosen to do what they would normally not do and turn away from God. Okay? So I named my sermon today, very interesting, The Deadly Influence of a Loving Frenemy. And a frenemy is a new term that has been coined recently, right? But because it's an oxymoron, isn't it? It's a contradictory upon itself. But the truth is that I have friendships who love me, and I love them. But because I have become a child of God, they become stumbling blocks. And what do? They're my friends and my enemies at the same time, it seems. But the Bible says we have to make a decision. And before we start, let's go ahead and just open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for your mercies, for your grace, and from your love. I thank you, Lord, that you are with us even now, Lord. And I pray for the fulfillment of your promise where you state that where two or three are gathered in your name, you will be there also. Lord, we need your spirit now. We need your spirit now. And to those, Lord, who you have been calling and calling and calling, Lord, call them once more. Let them hear your calling today and let them make a decision for you, Lord. Because at the end of the day, that's all that would matter. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, great. So we're gonna start by reading 2 Chronicles 17. And I'll actually just go over the story. It's a very popular story. So 2 Chronicles chapter 17 speaks about a king named Jehoshaphat. Many people are aware of King Jehoshaphat. And King Jehoshaphat was the fourth king of Judah. And he became to reign when he was 35 years old, and he reigned for 25 years. He was the son of King Asa. And King Asa, we can read about starting 2 Chronicles chapter 15. And the Bible says that King Asa heard a word from the Lord in chapter 15. He heard a word from the Lord through the prophet Azariah, assuring him that if he was faithful to God, that the Lord would always be with him. And upon this message, King Asa started a revival within Judah. The Bible records that Asa puts away all idols from the land, and he restored the altars of the Lord. And when the nation saw that God was with him, they all rallied around him, and the whole nation made a covenant with God. What is interesting, it says that when the nation, and even Israel, who was separated from Judah, saw that the Lord was with him, the Israelites started to leave Israel and come over to Judah, so they also had a migration problem, apparently. But they wanted to be close to someone who was close to the Lord. And the Bible says that they came into a covenant. The whole nation came into the covenant with God, and those who refused to go into covenant were put away or were put to death. This is what the Bible states. And he was serious about this, King Asa, because in verse 16, 2 Chronicles 15, verse 16, it records that his grandmother made an idol to Asherah and violated the covenant that the nation had made with God. And when he found out, he took her idol, he cut it down, he broke it, he crushed it, then he burned it. But he didn't stop there. And he took her and removed her from being mother queen. This was his grandmother, y'all. But he was serious about the covenant that he made with God. So King Jehoshaphat had a good example of a godly man in his father. And now while Asa was not perfect and he became a grumpy old man in his old age, and nevertheless, he served as a positive role model to his son Jehoshaphat. And I have to remind myself, as parents, that how we act and what we do will always be of greater value than what we say. I've known some parents that said, they tell their children, you know, do as I say, not as I do. But when they grow up, that has not worked out so well for them. It, you know, this woman named Evangeline Booth, she was the general of the Salvation Army. She was once asked, how do you know, when do you know that you wanted to join the Salvation Army? This was her response. I saw my parents working for the people, bearing their burdens day and night. They did not have to say a word to me about Christianity. They lived it. How we live our life will keep and will shape the life of our children, the children's Christian life, and make their faith seem real to them. So King Asa had a good example to his son, made a good example to his son Jehoshaphat. Therefore, when it was Jehoshaphat's turn to rule, he followed in his father's footsteps. The Bible records that Jehoshaphat followed in the ways of the Lord, and his heart was devoted to the ways of the Lord. He even removed the high places where idols were being worshipped and also removed the poles of Asherah from Judah. In addition, it says about Jehoshaphat, 2 Chronicles 17:4. But Jehoshaphat sought the God of his father and followed his commands. So Jehoshaphat followed his father's footsteps. He followed Jehovah and he kept his commands. But it says this, rather than the practices of Israel. Why would the Bible say that, speaking about Judah and speaking about Jehoshaphat? There's a distinction there. And the Bible wanted us to notice the distinction. You see, Judah decided to follow the Lord under the rulership of Jehoshaphat. But Israel was under the rulership of King Ahab, where he was living with open rebellion and idolatry. The Bible makes a clear distinction between the two kingdoms. And what makes it worse is that Ahab wasn't just bad. The Bible says that he did more evil in the sight of the Lord than anyone before him. He was the worst. And it came to pass, it says, as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. And he took a wife of a Jezebel. We all know Jezebel. She was the daughter of the high priest of Baal. And then he went and he served Baal and he worshiped him. The Bible is saying that King Ahab not only turned away from God, but did not feel anything about it. He thought it to be a light thing, the Bible says. And he caused the nation to turn to idolatry and made it acceptable and common to the people to worship Baal. So it's interesting to me that when I read 2 Chronicles chapter 18, the Bible records that Jehoshaphat went to visit Ahab. For what? Why would a good king, Jehoshaphat, go to visit this bad king? But after doing some research, I found that the reason for the visit was because he had spent years trying to build an alliance with Israel. Historians indicate that Judah and Israel had reached an alliance, and it was sealed by the marriage of Jehoshaphat's son, Jehoram, and Ahab and Jezebel's daughter, and Ahab and Jezebel's daughter Athaliah. So he had made an alliance with King Ahab. He built a relationship with King Ahab. He spent time, money, and resources building this relationship. So he had invested in this relationship. And this is why we find King Jehoshaphat going to see this bad King Ahab. And I ask myself, did God approve of this relationship? Did he counsel God before coming in this alliance? The answer has to be no. We are reminded in 2 Chronicles 6:14-15. Be ye not unequally yoked together with the unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And Ahab was living his life as an infidel at this point. He had rejected the call of God over and over and over again. You see, God for many years had tried to evangelize Ahab. And he gave him privileges that many of us would never have. You see, Ahab was present when God shut up the heavens for 3.5 years and there was no rain. Ahab was present when Elijah prayed to God at Mount Carmel and he saw fire come down from heaven and burn the sacrifice. Ahab was present when Elijah, filled with the Holy Spirit, ran in front of his chariot. And at the prayer of a faithful prophet, the heavens opened again and rain started to pour down. Ahab was present. And Ahab experienced personally the grace of God when he allowed a poor man to be unjustly killed in order for him to take his land and build a vegetable garden. This was Ahab. And after all this, Ahab continued to harden his heart to the calling of God. And Jehoshaphat knew this, and he continued to make this alliance. And the Bible records that when Jehoshaphat arrives at the location with Ahab, he asked him a question, Ahab. He says, hey, will thou go with me to Ramoth Gilead? And he answered him, he says, I am as thou art. We're like one people, and my people as thy people, and we will be with thee in war. But then he says something. And this is, don't agree to something so quickly and so harshly, please. Because he says, wait a minute, maybe I should consult the Lord. And he says, he asks the king, inquire, I pray thee, at the word of the Lord today. And I ask myself, really, why did he do that? He already promised that he was going. Why he do that? He sounds like he has his mind made up. But if you ask the question, the Lord is going to respond. And the Lord says this. So initially, when Ahab said, okay, I'm going to bring some prophets, he starts to speak. And he says, well, he makes a show out of it. And he says he brings 400 prophets. And they all say, go up, for God will deliver you, for God will deliver it into the king's hands. But they must have said it in a different way, in a certain way, because King Jehoshaphat wasn't really convinced. And the Bible commentary doesn't say that there were prophets of Baal, but it did say this, that they were false prophets. So Jehoshaphat said, is there not a prophet from the Lord that we may inquire of him? And they have response, there is one man. There's yet one man that we may inquire of the Lord, but I hate him because he never prophesies good, but always bad to me. Now, I like this statement. I like this statement because there was yet one man. You could say whatever you want about him. You could not like him personally, but there is a man or woman, right? So he didn't get this man. There was yet one man of God who was not persuaded by the promises of riches, nor the fears of threats. He was not moved by the influence of the power of the king, nor worried about the threat of persecution. Here was a man who stood on the word of God, unmoved, unwavering, willing to say the truth at all costs. And today what the world needs is missing is men and women of integrity to move forward with a thus says the Lord. Not influenced by the popularity of the culture, but speaking the truth given to us in the word of God. Micaiah was his name, the man of God. And when he was brought in front of the king, he said, all right, I'll tell you what you want to hear. He says, go, you should prosper. And the king got upset because he must have said it sarcastically. He said, didn't I tell you to tell me the truth of what the Lord is telling you? And he said, oh, you want to hear the truth, okay? He said, I see all Israel scattered upon the mountains. as sheep that have no shepherd. He didn't say, I see Judah. He said, I see Israel. He was the king of Israel. He said, there's going to be sheep having no shepherd. He was the shepherd. He was the king of Israel. And he's telling Ahab this. Pay attention here. He's telling him this. Ahab, if you go to battle, you're going to die. I want to know if I'm going to do something wrong, that the Lord is going to send somebody to me and say, don't do that because you're going to die, because I'm not going to do it. But Ahab's heart was so hardened that he could no longer appreciate the warning of God. And the very warning against judgment and death became repulsive to the point of anger to Ahab. And what's worse is that the good king that had heard the word of the Lord, the good king that says, let's inquire of the Lord, still decided to go with him to war. I don't understand. So they formulated a plan. They said, this is how we're going to avoid divine judgment. Think about this. This is how we're going to avoid divine judgment. They said, this is what these two kings, I want you to keep that in context. Two kings, and they were trained in the art of war. They get together and they say, this is what we're going to do to avoid divine judgment. And Ahab says, I'm going to disguise myself. No wonder the Bible says, those who reject the Lord, prophesying to be wise, become fools. This is the worst plan ever. I'm going to go out there, but I'm going to disguise myself so they don't know that I'm the king. But it gets worse. Look at this. Ahab tells Jehoshaphat, but you wear your kingly robes. I'm going to disguise myself, but you wear your kingly robes. Think about this, y'all. If the plan works and God thinks that I'm you, then I'm going to die. No, thank you. But they go with the plan. They go with the plan. Lord have mercy. And the Bible records that when they go to war, the enemies thought that Jehoshaphat was King Ahab. Yeah. And they said that they started to chase after him. But Jehoshaphat cried out. This was the king. This wasn't a Lord have mercy on me. No. He cried out. He was yelling, I'm not Ahab. Lord, please help me. He cried out. But it says this, and the Lord heard his prayer. And the Lord heard his prayer, and he caused the people to stop chasing him. I'm glad the Lord still answered the prayer of fools. I'm really glad. You see, but regardless of the attempt to avoid divine judgment, the Bible records that a soldier shot an arrow at venture. You know what that means, at venture? It means he wasn't even aiming. There was a soldier with an arrow sitting on the wall, and he saw a cluster of enemies, and he just shot it at venture. He wasn't even aiming. But the hand of God and the judgment of God had already been foretold. And the hand of God guided that arrow to the point that it says, and it smote the king, it smote Ahab of Israel between the joints of the harness. And he died shortly after. The king was fully armored for protection. But that did not matter because what God says will come to pass. You can tell, you can yell and argue, you cannot believe. You can say it's not right. You can say it doesn't make sense. You can say whatever you want to say. God doesn't need you to agree with him. What he says will come to pass. And when the battle was over, we were left with two kings, one dead and one a fool. So we asked, what drove this godly man to disregard the word of God? What caused him to have such a great lapse of judgment? And the first reason is this: earthly alliance were to him of more importance than his heavenly alliance. And when you try to be faithful to man and God, by default, you're unfaithful to God. But it's interesting because while I was shaking my head at King Jehoshaphat, God brought my own embarrassing experience. This may get me kicked out of eldership, y'all. You see, some years back, I have a friend who I love. He is my brother. And he was having his big birthday. He said, "I want you to come. You need to be here." And I said, "All right, I'll go." But I know that if he's going to be there, you know, the other friends are going to be there. The crew is going to be there. And I know what they do. They do things that a godly man shouldn't be around. But I said, "I'll go." And on that, they set the date for, you know, Saturday night, we go to church. Towards the afternoon, me and my wife, we head over to some friends in South Jersey, and we spend the day there, and the entire time, it's just bothering me in my spirit. And on the way back, I said, "Lord, I already knew I shouldn't go, but I said, Lord, if you don't want me to go, Lord, just show me a sign that I don't have to go." This is an internal prayer. I said, "Show me a sign that I don't have to go." And you know what happened as soon as I finished the prayer? They shut down the turnpike. I'm not talking about a lane. Not a lane. They shut down the entire turnpike. But the truth is that when I was asking God, I had already made up my mind. And I found an alternative route. And I took some side streets and avenues. And I got home 2 hours late. And as soon as I got home, I went into the bathroom and started to get dressed. And my wife walked in the bathroom. She said, you know how women say, right? "Oh, you still going? Oh, you still going?" And I said, just for a little bit, say happy birthday, come back, fooling myself. But it gets worse. See, I reached my friend's house. And I'm like, "All right, what we going to eat?" And he says, "No, we going to a spot in Queens." I thought we going to eat. He said, "I mean, they have food there, I think." And I'm there, but I love him. I want to support him. I have an alliance to him. And we go to Queens. And we go to the front of this place where they have the lines outside. And the big guys in the front. And one of our friends lifts up his hands, and the big guy says, "Oh, I got you." And he opens the line. And the spirit is fighting within me. "Go home." But I go in, and I'm sitting there, and I'm just like, "Lord." And as the time goes by a little bit, I'm just sitting there, and I say, "Lord, I'm sorry. I shouldn't be here." And I heard a voice, not a pleading voice, a commanding voice, said, "Go home now." And I got up. I shook his hand, I didn't say a word, and I ran up out of there and I went home. And the next day I'm awakened by a call from one of my friend's teenage son. And he says, Elvis, you okay?" I said, "Yeah, I'm fine. What happened?" And he says, "No, apparently something happened. And after you left, something happened and a huge fight broke out. And daddy's in the hospital." So I'm still happy that God answered the prayer of fools even today. And I thank God that he answered my prayer when I was a fool. And I thank God that regardless of all my errors and mistakes leading me to this bad decision, I experienced God's mercy and grace on that day. And I was reminded that we serve a God who's still in the business of saving his children. But I also learned another valuable lesson, that Jesus was serious when he said, if it causes you to sin, cut it off. And he wasn't even talking about friends. He went to something much more personal and valuable to each one of us. He said, if your right hand or if your right eye causes you to sin, plug it out, cut it off, cast it far from you. For it is better for one of your members to perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Jesus is not promoting self-mutilation. He is simply saying that the reward is so great and the punishment so severe that what you consider to be the most important in this world have no value in comparison to heaven and to the promise that is given to every one of his children. And this is what it is. Forget what people think about you. Forget what they may say. If your friend, wife, mother, child, grandmother causes you to sin, it says, cut it off. And I know this sounds harsh, but Jesus says, anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves child or daughter or son more than me is not worthy of me. Jesus is saying that our relationship and alliance to him has to be first. The second reason I believe Jehoshaphat went to war was because regardless of what the prophet said, he depended on himself and his own resources. You see, Jehoshaphat had built a great army. In chapter 17, it states that he had an army of over 1,160,000 men. So while he didn't have the approval of the Lord, he found assurance in his resources. He's got, I know what the Lord said, but I think I got this. And he went to war and he failed. And he also learned a valuable lesson that day. He learned what David knew years before. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. And this is why when we find Jehoshaphat in chapter 20, when this great multitude comes around him and tries to start a war, the first reaction of Jehoshaphat is not to build an alliance with Egypt, not to build an alliance with his neighbor. He doesn't start counting soldiers. He doesn't start saying how much soldiers we have or resources we have put away. He says, I need to hear a word from the Lord. I need to hear a word from the Lord. My friends, our alliances are not going to matter on that great day of judgment. What the people think of us, what our friends think of us, what our families think about us, what we even think about ourselves is not going to matter. Paul puts it this way, 1 Corinthians 4:3. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged of you. But he continues, he says this, or by man's judgment. He says, yea, I judge not my own self. Because Paul understood that on that great day, there is only one opinion that's going to matter, and that is God's. And many of us are fighting a war against ourselves, you know. We have taken a stand, and we're not going to move. We have said, I refuse to forgive this person. They did me wrong, and they deserve to be punished. And we even go out, and we find alliances that would agree with us to further justify our position, or the position we have taken. But I tell you this, all of your friends could agree with you. All of your colleagues could agree with you. Your family could agree with you. The church could agree with you. You could go to court and win, and the judge could agree with you. But if God doesn't agree with you, it means nothing. Means nothing. Because the standard of Christian living is different than the standard of the world. Because Jesus says in Matthew 5:44, guess what? Love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them that despitefully use and persecute you. This is the standard of Christian living. And if you're going against it because you don't agree with it, it's not going to matter at the end. Because this is what God is requesting from his people. And you know, Jesus lived his life this way. Jesus walked the earth proclaiming the gospel. He spoke of the goodness of the Father, and all that he did in accordance to his Father's will. He says, my meat, my food, my sustenance is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. This is what drove him. He understood that the relationship that truly mattered is one that he had with the Father. But the beauty is this. You see, when you come to God and you commune with God and build a relationship with God, then all your other relationships benefit from it. My wife would ask me and say, baby, do you love me? I said, I love you more now than the day I married you. I feel a different love for my children, for my wife. I feel a different, they enhance it. So it doesn't rob from other relationships. It increases. So if you have a problem in your relationship, go to Christ. Look what the Bible says. Jesus says this in 1 John 13:35. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Because when you accept him, the perfect love of God is reflected in you, and you start to see people for where they are. And then not only do you love them and they see that love, but they get closer to you and you point them to God. And you know what happens? They start to inquire. And then you show them why you're so happy and so joyous and so peaceful and why you love them so much more, even after they did so and so to you. And they say, how? And then you show them how. And then you know what happens to them when they accept God? They come into the same relationship, receive the same spirit. And then they too then build on their relationships. And when they accept, then they accept, and they accept. And it's the one spirit living in all of us, talk about unity and love and relationship. So if you have relationship issues in your marriage, focus on God. See it get better. If you're having issues with your children, focus on God. It's going to get better. If you have issues with your boss, focus on God and it will improve. Whatever relationship your life may be suffering, the answer is to focus on God. Because God is the God of relationships. He is. So Jesus did not let anything get in the way of his relationship with his Father. Not what anyone thought of him. Not what he wanted. His only joy was found in knowing that he lived a life in accordance to the will of God. And it says that Jesus knew not to depend on men, because the truth is the arm of flesh will fail you. It will. See, when Jesus entered Jerusalem and people were singing, Hosanna, Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and were waving their palm branches, less than a week later, there was the same ones yelling, crucify him. But God will never leave you. God will never betray you. God will never fail you. And this is the relationship we got to focus on. You know, in the Mount of Gethsemane, he prayed. Jesus prayed. He said, my Father, if it be possible, may this cup be taken from me. But then he continued. He says, yet not my will, but thy will be done. And Jesus drank that cup of shame and of pain that was assigned to you and to me. They took my Jesus. They mocked him. They spit in his face. They smacked him, they beat him with whips. They stripped him naked and paraded him around the streets of Jerusalem while he carried my cross. They placed a crown of thorns in his head, and finally they nailed him to the cross, and to a cross that was meant for you and me. See, when Jesus died, the world thought that he was a fool. He was labeled as a failure and a fraud. All of the disciples left him. Peter, one of his closest friends, became ashamed of him. And they mocked him and say, he saved others, but himself he cannot save. But Jesus understood that while the world did not understand him or approve of him, and what we saw in failure, he had accomplished his mission. Because he defeated sin in the flesh and was able to withstand all the attacks of the devil. And he remained faithful to his Father even unto death, the death on the cross. And while he died, despised and hated, when he was resurrected, he became King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And was given, and he was exalted and given a name above all names. The name of Jesus, the Bible says, that every knee should bow, things on heaven and things on earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and was given all power in heaven and in earth, and will be given a kingdom that will last forever and ever and ever and evermore. And he wants you to be a part of that kingdom. Today, he wants to change your citizenship status. He wants your name to be written in the Lamb Book of Life. And this could only happen if you accept him as Lord and Savior and you come into a relationship, an intimate relationship with him. And if you do that, he will not only bless you, but he will bless your relationships. He will bless your life, and you will gain more than you could possibly think or imagine. Don't be like Ahab today. Don't harden your heart. If the Spirit spoke to you today, answer him. If God has called you today, he may have been calling you all your life. You may have felt his calling 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, and you just wouldn't answer. But if he's calling you today, answer him. Accept his calling. Come into a relationship with him. For the reward is greater, and you don't want to miss it. Jesus says, "Behold, I am coming soon, and my reward is with me. And I want my reward. I want my reward." So if this is your wish also today, once we get on our feet, we get on our feet and say, "Lord, I want my reward. I want my reward. I want to come into a more and intimate personal relationship with you so that I could be a blessing to others as well." Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you, Lord, for your word, for it is in fact true, Lord. I want to thank you, Lord, because you are in fact the God of relationships, Lord. There are so many individuals, Lord, who are in bad relationships, Lord, being hurt by them, Lord. But I pray that at this point, Lord, that you're able to come closer to them, that they may invite you to be in their lives, that they may experience the joy and peace that only you could provide, that they may be able to understand, Lord, that as they come closer to you, not only are you a blessing to them, but they become a blessing to others around them. Lord, and today, Lord, someone has come here today. Someone has come here today and heard the calling from your Holy Spirit. And it's saying, "Come, I'm calling you. I want you to be part of my family. I want to abide in you, Lord." Lord, harden not their hearts. Let them be able to answer that call. For we don't know the time, the day, or the hour, Lord, that you will be coming, Lord, and probation will be closed. But we know that today, Lord, today we have an opportunity to choose you and have the privilege to be called the children of the living God. So, priest, Lord, touch their hearts. Let them make a decision for you, Lord. Let them be able to say, "I want to be counted worthy, Lord. I want to be called the son of God and daughter of God." I pray for this church, Lord. I pray that as we continue to move forward, Lord, that you guide us in all that we do and that we put you first. Regardless of our friends, things, family, husbands, wives, that our first lines may be to you, Lord. Because at the end of the day, what we want to hear is, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Lord, that is our prayer. Those are our wishes, Lord. Remember our names when you return. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for the opportunity. You may be seated.
We'll sing for our closing hymn, hymn number 590, Trust and Obey. Let us all stand.
Servant who allowed your spirit, who allowed his spirit to be used by you. And Lord, we pray as we leave here that the words that we heard today may be buried deep in our hearts, so that when we leave here and when we go out for the next week and whenever we go out, that we realize that relationships matter. And that our relationships need to be blessed by you. Bless us to this end, we pray. In the name of Jesus, amen. Let's sing our three amens.
Amen. is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise Him, He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise His name. He is the Lord, forever His truth shall reign. The King is exalted on high. I will praise Him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise His name. He is the Lord. Forever His truth shall reign. Rejoice in His holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise Him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise His name. He is the Lord, forever His truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in His holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. On high, He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. Thank you.